Thank you. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 23029 in the name of Neil Findlay on Amnesty International report as if expendable. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate, please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Neil Findlay to open the debate. Mr. Findlay, please.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, and can I declare an interest as my mum is a resident in a care home and my wife and daughter both work in the NHS. None of what I'm about to say is a criticism of care home staff who have worked, in my view, heroically under the most intolerable pressure throughout all of this crisis. The United Nations General Secretary, Antonio Guterres, said of the COVID pandemic, our response to COVID-19 must respect the rights and dignity of older people. Those words have never rung more hollow when we look at how older people have been treated over the last 8 months. It's my view that the treatment of the people who saw us through the war and the rebuilding of our country, who built the houses we live in, the welfare state we rely on, and the economy we benefit from, the people who brought us into this world, who cared for us, who nurtured us, loved us, and provided for us, has been nothing short of a shameful human rights violation and blatant discrimination. Excuse me. The Amnesty International report, as if expendable, is a damning critique of what happened in care homes in England. It sets out clearly how the UK government knew that a highly infectious respiratory illness could have a massive impact on the older population if appropriate measures were not taken. It identified how, and I quote, the UK government, national agencies and local bodies took decisions and adopted policies that have directly violated the human rights of older residents of care homes in England, most notably their right to life, to health and non-discrimination. These violations impacted on their rights to private and family life and may have violated their right not to be subjected to inhumane or degrading treatment. Inhumane or degrading treatment. And, Presiding Officer, whilst the report refers to policy and decisions and practice in England, almost every issue it raises was replicated here in Scotland. Because just as in England, we saw the complete failure to plan for the pandemic, despite the claims made by the government and their advisers. We also had major shortages of PPE for staff working on the front line, many forced to buy their own kit. We all recall the schools and businesses making face shields on 3D printers and people buying stock from eBay as they desperately tried to protect themselves and their residents. We also saw the mass discharge of patients previously stuck in hospital, their families misled into believing there was no care home place or care at home package for them, then saw them shipped out of hospital overnight to clear beds for COVID patients. 3,600 patients discharged in March and April alone. These patients were not individually risk assessed prior to discharge, and the care homes they were sent to were not risk assessed to determine whether they could cope. Care home managers have said that they felt pressured into taking patients they were unprepared for. We know that 82% of these patients were discharged untested, and that was in keeping with the guidance from the Scottish Government. No one knows how many had COVID, which was then spread through the home. But we do know that 338 patients were sent to care homes following a positive test, a deliberate and informed decision. And of course, staff were not tested either. On the BBC disclosure programme, Angela Akerer said it was the middle of April before staff were finally tested. Three of us were positive. God knows how long we'd been infectious for. By the time I got back to work a fortnight later, more than 20 of our residents had died. What a way to treat care home staff, who are amongst the greatest heroes of this crisis. At this time, we were told by the First Minister To be blunt, based on what I have been told, the UK and Scotland within it probably has the greatest testing capacity of any country in the world, proportionately per head of population. Presiding officer, this statement has no relation to reality, because today we are still not testing care at home staff. Neither are we routinely testing all the NHS staff, not even the ones whose wards have COVID positive patients in them. Still not being tested. Presiding officer, there can't be an MSP who hasn't heard from families of residents in care homes who have told us that their family member was ill and denied access to hospital for treatment at a time when many hospital wards were well below capacity and the Louisa Jordan Hospital lay empty. On this, Angela, the carer I referred to earlier, said, "We had 22 residents die in 3 weeks, and none of them had gone into hospital. It was like there had been a directive from somewhere. It was so upsetting. I don't know if any of them would have survived if they had gone into hospital, but none of them got the chance. It was like they were just written off. Many were never tested, never had a visit from a GP, and were denied access to hospital treatment in their time of need." This was, in my view, a policy hidden behind the guise of clinical decision-making. And like in England, we also had the abuse and misuse of do not attempt resuscitation orders, with patients pressured into agreeing them, with families often finding paperwork in the bottom of a hospital drawer or a bag of washing to go home. Age Scotland advised me today that they were inundated with calls about this issue to their call centre. Presiding officer, all of this happened in Scotland as well as England. And let me say this absolutely clearly. If it happened in Wales and if it happened in Northern Ireland too, then my criticisms are just as strongly levied at administrations there. But the highest proportion of care home deaths in the UK were in Scotland. As Amnesty says, it was as if our older people were expendable. It was as if those in power had decided that our mums and dads, our grandparents and older friends would be the collateral damage in the fight against COVID. It is for these reasons and many more that I agree 100% with Amnesty that there's a full independent public inquiry into the UK government's handling of the crisis should begin now. But we must also see the Scottish inquiry begin now too, without any delay, without any wasting of any more time. Presiding officer, how many times have we heard politicians and policymakers mouth the words about judging a society by the way it treats its most vulnerable citizens? The average age of people discharged from hospital with care homes is 81. Many have multiple health conditions, some have dementia. These are some of our most vulnerable and needy citizens. They have been subjected to clear age discrimination, a protected characteristic under the Equalities Act and the Public Sector Equality Duty. Their human rights have been violated and they have been exposed to inhumane and degrading treatment. If this is a judgment of our society, then we should all hang our heads in shame.
Thank you very much, Mr. Findlay. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Brian Whittle. Mr. Brown, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The COVID-19 pandemic is without a doubt the most serious public health crisis any of us have faced during our lifetimes, and its impact on care homes across the world has been devastating. So let me therefore start by first conveying my condolences to all those who have lost a loved one to the novel coronavirus, but especially to those whose loved ones were resident in care homes, as is true for so many of us. I'd also like to extend my gratitude to frontline care home staff for their compassionate and tireless work during the ongoing pandemic. I got a graphic reminder of that when my niece, who works in a care home in North Wales, told me about having to sit with an elderly patient as she passed away from coronavirus, and also the next day being spat at and shouted at by relatives of residents when they were told they were unable to visit their loved ones. If I'd also been told that somebody hoped that she would die from COVID-19. So the staff have had a terrible time of this throughout the pandemic for many months. So like many of my colleagues, I am also concerned about the findings in Amnesty International's As If Expendable report, according to which the human rights of older residents in England's care homes have been violated during the pandemic. Sadly, the report suggests that key policies and decisions taken by the UK government have caused a high number of unnecessary deaths and directly impacted people's rights to life, to health, to non-discrimination, to private and family life, and to not be subjected to inhuman treatment, amongst others. The report also concludes that the discharge of 25,000 hospital patients to care homes in March and April exponentially increased the risk of transmission to the very population most at risk of severe illness and death from the disease. Considering the damning findings of this report, I believe the least the Prime Minister ought to do now is follow the recommendations set out in the Amnesty International report and urgently launch the independent public inquiry which he promised to the English people earlier this year. I've only got 4 minutes. Such a public inquiry presents an opportunity to analyse and rectify the key issues which have negatively affected the rights of older and vulnerable people in care homes in England. I won't use the report about English care homes to have a go at the Scottish Government, but I think it's very important that we acknowledge the situation here in Scotland. And for that reason, I'm very grateful that, as early as August, the Scottish Health Secretary already commissioned a Public Health Scotland report on discharges from NHS hospitals to care homes during the first coronavirus wave in Scotland. Indeed, we owe it to residents, families and staff to have accurate data and independent analysis on the transfer of patients to care homes and the impact that had in said care homes. I'm also relieved that the report does not find statistical evidence that hospital discharges of any kind were associated with care home outbreaks in Scotland. Indeed, after accounting for care home size and other characteristics, detailed statistical modelling found that the estimated risk of an outbreak was not statistically significant. Nonetheless, we have to accept that, as in all other countries, some mistakes were also made in the handling of this unprecedented crisis in Scotland. The report, for instance, finds that guidance, according to which two negative tests were required before discharge to care homes, was not implemented consistently enough in late April and May. The First Minister therefore rightly emphasised in her speech last week that the Public Health Support Scotland's findings will not be of comfort to those who have lost a loved one in a care home during this pandemic, and that they don't take away from the duty of government to learn and apply lessons. It's commendable that, unlike the UK Prime Minister, the First Minister has never shied away from accepting responsibility from the decisions that her government took at any stage of this devastating pandemic. And I'm therefore confident that as we go through the second wave of this crisis, her and her cabinet will continue to show responsible leadership and do their utmost to protect the people of Scotland from this deadly virus. I'm particularly pleased that the Scottish Government has already shown willingness to take forward the recommendations set out in the PHS report and is committed to continuously adapt their guidance in order to protect care home staff and residents according to the latest data, clinical advice and scientific evidence. I have therefore no doubt that the Government will also closely analyse Amnesty International's report on the UK Government's handling of the crisis and implement the recommendations set out in the report in Scotland wherever it makes sense to do so. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brown. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Monica Lennon. Mr. Whittle, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Neil Findlay for bringing this debate to the Chamber? I think it's a topic that can't be brought to the attention of the public too many times. Like Mr. Findlay, I would like to start by thanking the incredible staff and carers who have looked after our most vulnerable in such difficult times with such dedication and professionalism. There are so many stories of compassion, and it is important that when we have these debates, we always caveat our comments by acknowledging the debt that we owe our care staff and our NHS staff. We also recognise that the Amnesty International report, As If Expendable, focuses on the shortcomings of policy decisions made by the UK Government in the English care system. In no way should any of us shy away from that or try to lessen the questions that will have to be answered by those who made those choices and decisions. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, we cannot allow the Scottish Government to hide behind the fact that this particular report pertains to England, because all the indicators in Scotland are just as bad, if not worse, in some instances. Tonight's debate cannot be about a Scottish Government trying to wiggle off the hook by saying we are not as bad as them in this or that. So let's be absolutely clear. Listening to my learned gentleman here shout from a seated position, all government responses in the UK have been seriously flawed. This is no time to hide behind party loyalty. However, it is our job in this place to scrutinise the questions and question the Scottish Government decisions. And I know I'm continually raising the care home crisis with the Scottish Government on behalf of my constituency. Hardly a day goes by without care homes being the subject of emails and phone calls to my office. And it does seem increasingly clear to me that there has been mistake after mistake in handling the most vulnerable in our society. In Scotland, there has been 2,017 tragic deaths from COVID in care homes since the start of the pandemic, some 45% of care home deaths. A Public Health Scotland report revealed that over 113 patients were sent to care homes despite being tested positive for COVID, with some 3,061 patients being discharged into care homes without being tested. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, it was acknowledged and accepted right at the start of this crisis that mistakes would be made. The main and recurring issue that I have is the Scottish Government's continual attempts to hide from the truth, to hide from simple parliamentary questions. Take the simple question, when did you know that COVID-positive patients or patients who have not been had a test were being transferred into care homes? How many times has that question gone unanswered in this chamber? Had it been answered at the very first time with a degree of honesty, it wouldn't have been the issue it has now become. The question in my mind has always been around our initial response. We watched the virus begin in China, move across the world, move across Europe towards us, with the devastating effect on countries like Italy and Spain and France, especially on the most vulnerable. Yet we were still caught unprepared. Now, I asked the Cabinet Secretary about that very question, and her response was, we did the same as the rest. Why did you do the same as the rest, though? What different outcome did you expect to happen? The wise learn from their mistakes, and the truly wise learn from other people's mistakes. We should have been able to protect our most vulnerable better than we did. I have to say, as an aside, Deputy Presiding Officer, for another time and another debate, we do need to get into the role that data collection and analysis needs to play, because I think we've been woefully short in that department, and that's a real game changer going forward. As I said, it was accepted mistakes would be made. Advice would be ever-changing as we learn more about the virus, but keeping Parliament away from effective scrutiny only raises Parliament's suspicions more. The Scottish Government has asked for our support. So be straight with the Chamber then, and own your mistakes. If that had been done, you would have found a Chamber more able to support. If that had been done, we'd be more open for discussion, more open for input across the Chamber. Perhaps then we'd be in a better place. I think too often party politics have meant that suspicion from the Scottish Government have prevented openness and collaboration. Deputy Presiding Officer, this virus is not going away, despite what many thought might have happened by now. The response from across the world, including the Scottish Government, has been far less sophisticated than it should have been by now. It's time to take a breath. We will get the opportunity to look over the coals when we're on the other side of this pandemic. Terribly difficult decisions have been placed in front of governments. We all recognise that. In the meantime, though, the Amnesty report calls into question the response south of the border, and they will have to own an answer to that. The Scottish Government must own their own poor decisions and their mistakes and map out a more cohesive way out of this crisis that we all have confidence in. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call Monica Lennon to be followed by Alison Johnson. Ms Lennon, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by thanking Neil Findlay for bringing this vital issue to the Chamber and for his powerful speech tonight, and also want to thank Amnesty International for compiling the report as if expendable. What has happened to many care home residents during this pandemic has often shocked and horrified at home here in Scotland, but indeed across the world. Behind the statistics of how many social care staff are being tested, how many patients have been discharged from hospital to care homes, tested or otherwise, and the overall level of care home deaths are the heartbreaking realities of lives torn apart and families separated by this awful pandemic. And as always, my thoughts are with all of those who have lost loved ones to COVID during the course of this year. Locally, I have been in touch with dozens of families who were affected by a care home outbreak. One of my constituents lost a grandparent to COVID-19 at White Hills Care Home in East Kilbride, which suffered a significant outbreak earlier in the year. Over 23 residents died during the first wave. And some of these families that I've been speaking to have put it better than I ever could. In response to the Public Health Scotland report that this Parliament has talked a lot about, one constituent told me, and I quote directly from her, "The simple fact is that the admitted patients from hospital into care homes during this time, either tested or untested, common sense should have prevailed. And we have no doubt that this put my gran at greater risk of being exposed to the virus. It's unbelievable that this was allowed to happen. We trusted the management team when they told us my gran was in the safest place. And had we known this practice was taking place, we would have 100% taken steps to have her home with us. She was vulnerable and she should have been protected. We are heartbroken and feel very let down. Our gran wasn't just a number and did not deserve to die this way. Presiding Officer, no one deserves to die that way. When I asked NHS Lanarkshire to provide details under FOI to confirm or rule out that untested COVID-19 patients had been discharged from hospital to care homes that had had an outbreak, they said that this request was manifestly unreasonable, and I still don't have an answer. So I hope in response the Minister for Older People will say whether or not she agrees with me that that is not a manifestly unreasonable request, because families want these answers. And the Scottish Government, for its part, does need to be more transparent about their treatment of social care. We've heard about the Public Health Scotland report published last week, and you know what we heard from the First Minister isn't the last word. It shouldn't be. She's admitted that herself, but I, like others, strongly believe that the public inquiry needs to begin. At a minimum, the preliminary work needs to get underway so this Parliament can work with ministers to work out what the terms of reference should be, who will lead to that inquiry, what data needs to be gathered now. And for people who've lost loved ones, relatives who are in their 80s and their 90s, who've said to me, it might be too late for us to contribute in a year's time, in 2 years' time. So they want to feed into the process now. In terms of how we arrived at this point, I think it's worth a mention that all governments plan for pandemics. In Scotland, we had Silver Swan. At a UK level, there was Signet. In 2016, Dr. Gregor Smith led a review of Silver Swan, and delegates at a conference in the Tully Island Police College in 2016 warned that staff shortages would be a major problem in a pandemic. In the report itself, care homes get a single mention, a passing mention. That isn't good enough, and that can't happen again. The Cygnus report, which was the UK-wide planning exercise for pandemics, warned of the dangers of moving hospital patients to care homes during an outbreak. But this hasn't been properly addressed. So the warning bells were being rung back in 2016. In March of this year, once the pandemic had started, GMB Scotland wrote to the First Minister calling for a national care plan. We didn't get one. I welcome today that the government has published an adult social care winter preparedness plan, but it's taken us a long time to get there. Also, I've been calling for an older people's commissioner. We should have one, presiding officer. We can't change the past, but we must build a future where the rights of our oldest citizens will always be respected and upheld, starting now.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lennon. I call Alison Johnson, who is the last speaker in the open debate. Ms. Johnson, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. And I'd like to thank Neil Findlay for bringing this important subject to the chamber this evening. The motion in Mr. Findlay's name, which I'm pleased to support, highlights Amnesty International's report, which has the grim title, As If Expendable. But it's a fitting title for a report which makes grim reading. The report is dated the 4th of October, and it opens by stating COVID-19 has had a devastating impact on older persons living in care homes in England, with more than 18,500 dying in the first 3 months. And that figure is actually 18,562. And this chamber is only too well aware, and Brian Whittle mentioned that 2,017 people have died in Scotland's care homes. We've discussed previously, and we've discussed again this evening, the impact of discharge from hospital into care homes of patients infected or possibly infected. You know, this is clearly an issue of great concern. You know, Amnesty say in their report, they note that the UK government, national agencies and local level bodies have taken decisions and adopted policies during the pandemic that have directly violated the human rights of older residents of care homes in England, notably their right to life, their right to health and their right to non-discrimination. But it is absolutely the case that the UK has to look at this report and has to learn from it. Certainly.
Neil Findlay.
I wonder if Alison Johnson would join me in encouraging Amnesty Scotland to do a similar report on what happened here.
Alison Johnson.
I certainly would. I think that would be useful, helpful and very, very welcome. A failure to ensure regular testing of care home workers and residents has certainly been raised by myself, my own party and others. I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary on the 24th of April asking for routine testing for hospital and care workers. I welcome the fact that the government announced on the 25th of May that that would be introduced, but that's, you know, 4 weeks where potentially asymptomatic and contagious workers can be carrying the virus. And I know that was an issue of great concern to care workers. And colleagues have made this point. This debate in no way diminishes or reduces our respect. They have gone the extra mile. They have, you know, they have delivered so much care for so many people at a time of, you know, a national emergency. We have to look too at the fact that our care is delivered often, well, it's a profit-driven commercial system. And I would just like to state that in my view, care is not a business. Care is a right. I think we're looking at workers who've been underpaid and undervalued for such a long time. They shouldn't be working for peanuts, and they shouldn't be working for profits either. They should be allowed to do the best job they can because they've been invested in, trained properly, and paid properly. And we're all very well aware, too, that the gender pay gap is impacted negatively by the care sector. It's largely delivered prominently, you know, predominantly by women, and they do not have the support and the recognition that they deserve. And I hope, if anything, this pandemic goes some way to change that. I mean, Monica Lennon spoke about Silver Swan and Cygnus. These were simulation exercises to estimate the impact of a pandemic. I think they were looking at influenza pandemics, but it became only too apparent that there were gaps in the provision of PPE, ventilators, critical care beds, and staff. So this shouldn't have come as a surprise, but we've very much been caught on the back foot. You know, I appreciate that I'm out of time, presiding officer, but I think the more that we can work together to ensure dignity and respect for all who live and work in our care home, you know, this is well and truly now at the top of the agenda. I think we have to work together to address these issues. We have to work to properly integrate health and social care because they don't yet have parity of esteem. They're not properly integrated. We need to examine these issues as quickly as possible, and we need to ensure the effective participation of care home residents, their families and bereaved families. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I think members will know I have let members speak over their time, this important debate. Now I call on Christine McKelvey to close for the Government. Minister, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I thank everyone for their heartfelt contributions to today's debate, an incredibly important day, I'm sure, a debate that I'm sure we all agree on. We've heard many accounts of the devastating impact of this global pandemic on our care home sector. And at the outset, I would like to express my deepest sympathy for all those who have lost loved ones. And can I also, like others in the chamber today, thank the staff for the work they do every day to care for the people that we love. What is clear from the debate and the Amnesty International report is that it is important that we look back and learn from the early experiences of this pandemic. But it's also important that we look forward and act on that learning. And there's been many calls for that today from all of the contributions. As I look back, Presiding Officer, I can see that we have taken firm action from the outset to support care homes and protect the well-being of those who work and live in those homes. We have put in place a wide range of support for care homes This includes expanding and strengthening PPE supplies for providers, regular testing for care home staff, ensuring local oversight arrangements from the NHS and local authorities, and equipping the care inspectorate to carry out an enhanced assistance role. Since the 22nd of April, Presiding Officer, we have been testing all people admitted to care homes. We put into place robust weekly testing, and we have plans to extend testing to family, visitors, professional and other care home staff. We continue to provide funding across health and care services to meet the additional costs of responding to COVID-19 and to support service remobilisation. The Health Secretary announced funding of £1.1 billion on the 29th of September across NHS boards and integration authorities to meet costs arising from the response to the pandemic. We have also allocated a total of £150 million for social care as part of our additional COVID funding this year. In addition, we have also provided £1.16 million to local and national organisations which have been supporting older people through initiatives including helplines, food deliveries and friendship services. Presiding Officer, as we have been highlighted today, it's important that we learn lessons from the pandemic. In commenting on the UK Government's handling of the crisis within care homes, Amnesty International calls for a public inquiry. As you know, the First Minister has committed to such a public inquiry. It is right and proper that decisions taken during the pandemic face scrutiny in the fullness of time. We know that all parts of the system will want to reflect and learn lessons. And as Keith Brown says, we are continuously learning and adapting our guidance. Monica Lennon asked specifically about an issue that she's having with NHS Lanarkshire. I'm happy to investigate that with health colleagues and come back to Monica Lennon on that because I don't have the details to hand right now. Okay.
Ms Lennon.
Thank you. I'm grateful to the Minister for her offer. NHS Lanarkshire said that one of the reasons why they couldn't compile the information is because staff are very busy and they'd have to get into individual files. My colleague Neil Finlay has been having trouble getting FOIs because of the cost, and we've got people willing to crowdfund to pay for these documents. So is this something that the Minister could convene cross-party talks on? Because we're all putting in FOIs. We don't want to bog down the system, but people desperately do need answers.
Minister.
Okay, I think that's a fair enough inquiry, absolutely. I'll need to take this up with health colleagues to find out the details. But I hear what you're saying about maybe not bogging down a system that's already under pressure, and I'm sure the health staff will appreciate that. So let me go back and get that information, and I'll come back and let Monica Lennon know about that. Presiding Officer, Alison Johnson and others were talking about, you know, the things that we need to do, how we need to support the system, but also how we need to support to ensure that we look after people. So in that vein, we have commissioned an independent review of adult social care in Scotland, which will report in January. The review will look at the future of how social care is planned, funded and delivered in Scotland. Presiding Officer, as a former social care training officer, I can see the real benefit in ensuring that we do have that planned, funded and delivered in Scotland. Presiding Officer, I know that this is about the future.
I'm afraid it better be one, Mr. Fitzgerald. I'm simply not taking an intervention. That's not a point of order. Well, let me hear your point of order.
Sir, I think in my 10 years I've been in here, I've never attended a member's debate where the minister responding will not take any intervention from the person who proposes the debate.
That Mr. Finlay, is not a point of order. It's
outrageous. That's what
please
it is.
Sit
it's
down.
Outrageous.
Mr. Finlay.
Shameful.
Mr. Finlay, don't abuse points of order with me. You know perfectly well it's for the member to decide whether or not they take a point of order, whether it's you or anybody else. So don't do it. And please don't keep talking while I'm telling you something. Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've got a lot to get through to answer lots of Neil Finlay's points, and I'll continue to do that. Presiding Officer, I know that we've been talking about the future, but we also need to take action now. So in action now, that's why we heard earlier today the Cabinet Secretary has published our Adult Social Care Winter Plan for 2020-21. Using the learning from the pandemic, the plan sets out the measures to offer maximum protection for users of adult social care during the remainder of the pandemic and the winter. The Winter Protection Plan will be supported by further funding of £112 million for social care, and that's on top of the additional £150 million, so £262 million in total this year. This will help providers meet the additional cost of responding to COVID-19. The plan confirms our intention to expand in testing for groups of health and social care staff that visit care homes, for care home visitors and for home care staff. The Amnesty International report highlights the importance of supporting mental well-being and quality of life. Well-being is a key priority within the plan, which is why we are looking at what more we can do to open up further visitor options for family and friends to connect with their loved ones. We will work with partners to support consistent adoption of guidance and ensure that residents' human rights are fully respected and fulfilled. I know just how important those connections are to tackling social isolation and loneliness. I lead the work in the government on our strategy, and I'll meet this Thursday with the National Implementation Group in our Connecting Scotland strategy. Presiding Officer, it's very important that we continue to consider the needs of family and friends of loved ones in care homes. I have met members of the Care Home Relatives Group and others who have helped to enhance the most recent update to our visiting guidance. I can confirm that a website with information for families and friends on visiting will be launched very soon. I'm incredibly grateful to those families who help us develop our visiting policy that gives more, not just time, but more, the more important issue about human connection, something I think that we've all missed during this pandemic, a touch, a holding a hand, a hug, even a kiss. Presiding Officer, I would like to thank the member for holding this debate. This pandemic is far from over. There are indeed lessons that have been learned. Most importantly, supporting the care home sector, we will continue to require the collective actions of all of us, all of the time. And as we take those actions, we need to continue to listen. To listen to the lived experience of those whose lives are impacted by this pandemic. And one of the issues that Monica Lennon had brought up in her contribution was about a commissioner. And I think there is a tight time for broader considerations about a commissioner, and that's something I think the MSPs in this place should explore, and whether they come up with the ideas about the need for a commissioner or not. I will be looking forward to seeing those ideas. Presiding Officer, just in conclusion, I have said it many times before, getting older is a privilege not afforded to us all. We must celebrate our older people for the love, experience and knowledge that they give us. That includes ensuring that they are able to live their lives with dignity, supported by quality care and compassion. And as Minister for Equalities and Older People, I am committed, along with my ministerial colleagues, to doing just that. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.